The Dead Cat Bounce by Sarah Graves, narrated by Lindsay Ellison.
Chapter 1. My house is old and rambling and in some disrepair, and I think that it is faintly haunted. A cold spot forming inexplicably on the stairway, a scuttling in the hall. Then, of course, there is the matter of the enigmatic portrait, whose mystery I had not yet managed to resolve on that bright April morning when, after living cheerfully and peacefully in the house for over a year, I found a body in the storeroom. Coming upon a body is an experience like childbirth or a head-on collision that takes the breath out of a person. I went back through the passageway between the kitchen and the small unheated room where in spring I kept dog food and dahlia bulbs, and where apparently I now stored corpses. "Ellie," I said, "there's a dead man out there on the floor." Ellie White looked up from the kitchen workbench where she was planting pepper seeds, sprinkling a few into each little soil-filled peat pot to be set out later in the cold frame. Ellie has coppery hair cut short around a thin, serious face lightly dusted with freckles. Her pale blue eyes are so intense that even through her glasses, her gaze makes you feel your X-ray is being taken. Her index finger paused in the act of tamping soil onto a pepper seed. "Who?" she asked. Sometimes I think Ellie has formaldehyde in her veins. For instance, when I moved to Maine, I thought sill work meant painting them. And if you have ever restored an elderly house, you will understand the depths of my innocence. Sill work is slightly less radical than tearing the house down and starting over entirely, and almost as expensive. And if you don't do it, the old house ends up at the bottom of the cellar hole. Ellie, upon hearing that this was what my old house needed, merely remarked how lucky I was that I could pay for it, because she knew of another woman whose house had needed sill work too, and that woman was now living in the cellar hole. Ellie's comment shut me up pretty quickly, as she had intended, and I resigned myself to getting the job done in spring. But along about March, I discovered that sill work was only the beginning. There was also the poignant little problem of the rot-rattled floor joists, and of the support beams holding up the floor joists, or rather not holding them up. I don't know who. He's lying face down in the corner where everything sags. I should have had that floor jacked up last autumn. Ellie was wearing denim coveralls, a bright yellow turtleneck with jade-green turtles satin-stitched onto it, and shiny green gardening clogs over thick yellow socks. On anyone else, the outfit would have been hilarious. But Ellie is so tall and slender that she could wear a painter's drop cloth, possibly with a couple of frayed dish rags belted around it, and still look just like a Paris runway model. "I don't think the floor is the issue here," she said. "That's because it's not your floor. The only thing holding that floor up now is habit. And when the homicide detectives and the medical examiner and I don't know who all else start tramping in and out of there, then that floor is going to—" She was looking at me as if I'd just arrived from Mars. "Jacobia," she said, "I don't know what kind of law enforcement you got used to back in the big city where you come from." She picked up the telephone, dialed George Valentine's number, and let it ring. "But in case you haven't noticed, you're not in New York anymore. You're in Eastport, Maine, 3 hours from Bangor, and a heck of a lot farther from anywhere else. And the only person tramping in and out of that storeroom is going to be George. That is, if he ever answers his phone. He was over at my house earlier, but I don't know where he is now." Of course it was George's number. In Eastport, George was it. If you had a fire or a flood or a skunk in the crawl space, George was the man you wanted, which was lucky, since the rest were out on fishing boats, dragging for scallops, hauling lobster pots, or collecting sea urchins, depending upon the season. "I'm going out there," Ellie said after George had picked up at last and promised to be right over.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.